Good afternoon. I'm Dana Linda, another member of the Graduate Advisory Committee representing UCLA Comparative Literature. I would like to just add my words of welcome to you all today, being here with us for the second half of today's workshop. Here at Humanist.Work, we are committed to the job search needs of MAs and PhDs, as well as to inciting a new culture of humanities professionalization at the University of California. So it is with great enthusiasm that I introduce Jared Reddick to our fourth regional gathering. Jared is a career transition coach, executive resume writer, and corporate communication strategist who brings a valuable outside-in perspective to our workshop series. His client list includes executives and senior management professionals from hundreds of startups to Fortune 500 companies, including Amazon, Apple, Box, Disney, eBay, Google, McKinsey, Salesforce, and Yelp, to name a few. Prior to founding his San Francisco-based law firm, The Resume Studio, Jared worked as an executive recruiter with two national retained search firms, where he conducted searches for Fortune 15 companies, top 10 law firms, and leading nonprofit organizations and foundations. Though Jared's own resume demonstrates a strong track record of engaging in the private sector, he is himself, first and foremost, a humanist. Jared holds a Bachelor's of Arts with an emphasis in music education and performance from Abilene Christian University, and taught classical piano for over 20 years. He has also served as a founder and the artistic and executive director of a performing arts organization. More than this, he understands storytelling as a career skill that is vital to building a well-constructed resume. Jared has been a main proponent of Humanist at Work since its inception at Berkeley in 2014, where he has worked collaboratively with affiliated students and staff on custom career development solutions for humanities PhDs. His latest publication, Jared Reddick's Job Description Analysis, which you should have all received for this workshop, is a key component of our growing professionalization toolkit and helps students to refine and manage their career roadmaps. In this session today, Jared is going to demystify the resume writing process by helping us to tackle some of the complicated matters of translating the PhD experience into value-recognized contributions that hold traction beyond the academy. So please join me in welcoming Jared Reddick.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, it's nice to be back here, everybody, because I'm getting to know a lot of faces. I notice when you have hair color changes, I noticed all sorts of fun things that are going on. One of the other really exciting things is that we are building something incrementally and sort of having experiences like this and then sort of working quietly and then coming back and seeing and showing you what is next in the iteration. And eventually my hope is that everybody who has sort of the humanities track, or really it might even sort of expand beyond that, has a roadmap or some sort of a system by which they can go through and sort of analyze their experience. Because one of the really difficult challenges humanists have is that there are many, 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 many things you offer, and you don't know how the heck they might fit in the workforce or where you might want to go if you're not staying in a traditional sort of academic track, right? I should back up a little bit and say a special thank you to a couple of people. And I forgot my glasses, I realized, as I was standing there. So I'll just hold it out like this. I'm appreciative to, of course, Kelly and Dana and Anna and Ariel and Annie and some of those folks who conceived the ideas, participated in the development of this. Many of you, there are actually at this point quite a few, and so I can't name everybody, but I want to express gratitude to them. And it's because of what they're doing that we're able to have this conversation. We're going to talk today about a kind of small but very, very big important component to resume writing that I call buckets. And buckets, incidentally, are simply branded bullet points. And we're going to go in depth. And if you've been to one of these already, you've heard me talk about it. I think we have a runway that will ramp in and show you sort of what that's about. I should also, if you haven't yet downloaded the two different handouts that were on the link, have somebody at your table help you. Because in a moment, what you basically have is, we couldn't print out copies for 1,200 or 120 people. So you're going to want to set them on your computer screen like this, because the one on the left is going to be the case studies 1 through 5B plus three example buckets. The one on the right is going to be the actual case studies. And as I go through it, and sorry if you have a very small screen, as I go through it, you're going to be wanting to sort of cross-reference the two. So they want to be set side by side. So I appreciated in the last presentation that she spoke about branding. And branding, I will say, it took me a long time to get accustomed to and familiar with and appreciative of, because I didn't like to think of myself as a pianist, as a marketing person, or someone who's going to be branding myself. It seems so corporate. I fell into retained executive search, and I sort of had to embrace the idea of branding. And branding, again, is just saying who you are and being clear about it, and being willing to let 90% of the stuff and people that come at you go, and being that 10%. And this is where, you know, this is where I shine. So that's all branding is just defining who you are. I'll give an example. I'm really clear about my brand, and that's that I work with senior executives who are conducting a stealth job search. That's primarily who I work with. A stealth job search means they're doing something under the radar. They don't want their boards or their bosses to know that they're doing that. So when someone comes along to me and is a person who's taking care of their children, for instance, and they want to return to the workforce, that is not my specialization. However, I know someone who does just that. So that's an example of branding in a sort of a friendly way. We have with us today, yesterday we had, I thought, a really amazing conversation in the afternoon with career advisors who've come to join us. And because we kept thinking, how do we get this out of my brain if I'm hit by a bus? And how do we, you know, how do we translate this and make it something that flows out where it's helpful? Maybe across the UC system, maybe beyond that at some point. So yesterday, we sort of did a bit of a download, and I shared some ideas with career advisors who are today your table captains. Would you mind raising your hands so that people at your table know which person you are? Is there a table that does not have a table captain? Oh, we have two tables that need a table captain. Okay, some duplication is now going to, all right, yes. Where is the link for the PDFs? Say it again, and I'll try to say it out loud.
www.humwork.uchri.org. And then if you click on the workshop page, it'll be right under where Jared's speaking.
Oh, it just tweeted? Oh, it was tweeted, but now it's way down in the queue. Okay, I also know that some of you started the JDA this morning. Well, good luck with today's presentation. I have to say, though, that it was better than previous times where literally the day before and the morning of, it's like, as I did one time before, all these downloads coming into my email, I'm like, well, this is really not going to work. The good news is that a lot of you actually started several weeks ago, and I saw a steady trickle, and so I'm encouraged about that. So if you didn't do the JDA, you're going to hopefully... By the way, JDA is short for job description analysis. Hopefully someone at your table or near you can share what they've done, and you'll still benefit, I think, from the conversation. Okay, I've written something specific because I want to make sure all of it is said, and I am going to read it without my glasses. I think that writing clearly is really hard work. I think it's especially tough when you're having to write objectively about yourself, while simultaneously translating experience that's important, but not easily understood outside of, or maybe even alongside, a traditional academic track. Having to define what you do and have done, even when you may not know what you want to do, is the careers world that I'm in, and it's the careers world that we call, it's what we call career discovery. So this whole thing is talking about using the writing process as a tool for career discovery, it's inherent. And I was surprised last time when someone said I didn't understand that connection. I was surprised because, surprised at myself, because I live in this world, so it's so clear to me. But understand that the idea of struggling with a lot of these really difficult questions is the inherent career discovery. So the folks I work with, as I mentioned, are usually 15 to 25 years into their career, and they frequently will say this: if only I had known this when I was in graduate school, right? So that's basically where we are at this point. We have this opportunity to launch, to grow, to enhance your careers using some tools. And next time I'll wear my glasses. One big challenge for me, of course, is that I'm here addressing the translation of your story. If you think about sort of where you're looking or thinking about jobs that aren't obvious. And then, of course, that's what I've been discussing since Berkeley, careers alongside the academy. My challenge as an expert in sharing something that is as narrow as resume writing is that a document that can mean so much to your career and yet is so often untended until the last minute and frequently at a time that's frightening and disruptive in your life, my challenge is to translate what I do one-on-one with clients, with you guys, in a 1-on-80 experience, right? So my effort along this whole way has been translate, and maybe even develop a system. I think you have a similar challenge in that you are having to translate what you've done, your experience, to simplify it, make it clear to an audience that might not get it immediately. They might not understand it. It might not be in their own language, right? I think we're getting closer to that translation. And today I'm here to talk about not only those tools that I think will help, but also to show several examples, again, from peers to help with that. The other thing is you now have these links. Please do not lose them. Download them, save them, whatever, because they're designed for you to get a sort of an understanding today, but then also to, when you literally sit down and start facing this yourself in a big way, for the first time today, we have sort of a guide. So the very first part of that guide, and I have to switch back and forth, if you'll look at those pieces that you have in front of you, we're not gonna get to buckets yet. The buckets will be revealed momentarily. Pardon me just a moment. I actually want to back up a little bit. So using the writing process as a tool for career discovery, I want a couple of things, and you'll get these slides afterward. Instead of looking at a resume as a once and done experience or a chore, look at it as what? A dynamic and continual growth experience, because it's really going to help with your career and your career sort of discovery and growth. Developing a resume that works requires that you translate who you are with where you want to go. The work can help you explore where you want to go, not only now, but years from now. Things you do, or skills, will be what you use to translate your experience to a new audience. So those can lead, and they should lead, to a set of keywords, which we at some point will bucket, to use in your resume and beyond. And then keywords also become usable as clues in your search for potential new career paths. Finally, research and construct new discoveries as you always have, but this time on your own behalf. Think of yourself as your own subject. Think of yourself as the thing or the idea that you are researching and you're sort of advocating for. Track what you discover, be open to new ideas, and then keep following the breadcrumbs because your efforts are continual, your resume is just a strategic snapshot or moment in time, right? The career is going along, and this is who I am today. The career is going along, that discovery never ends, this is who I am today. So that's very much how I look at a resume. I'm gonna skip right through this because we have some really interesting table work, but there are some distinct differences between a CV and a resume. CVs are super long, resumes are super short. I'm going to borrow from Annie, who said the other day, a resume is an advertisement and a CV is a documentary. Okay, now we're getting to the things that you should have side by side. If you will open up and put on the left side The one that says in this weird green color, case studies 1 through 5B, plus 3 example buckets. Have that one on the left, and then on the right, of course, the other one. It might take a little bit of time if you've not already done that, but I'm going to discuss the color legend that's right here. Okay, so the following case studies and exhibits focus on design, document structure, hierarchy, with content following as a close second, and purpose should always be kept in mind. So I have a philosophy in my practice where I say documents, and I'm including LinkedIn in those documents, should follow a purpose, content, design, strategy. Everything starts from your purpose. If you don't know that, then the rest doesn't really matter, right? Now, you may have multiple purposes, or purpi, perhaps. And then you have the content, right? The content has to serve the purpose. Finally, you have design. Design has to support the content and the purpose, right? Design, so many times we get really stuck. We're like, oh, I love this design. That's such a beautiful resume. And then you try to shoehorn your story right into that. Well, it doesn't work that way, right? So there are design elements that work, and they should work for you, and you should stand sort of strong in that. The color legend here, if you think of the resume as an elaborate sort of outline, the following simple Microsoft Word colors will help us to quickly explain and illustrate the multi-level hierarchy required to turn a complex story into a clear and simple narrative. See where it's green? So that green, I call those that green parent ideas, and we're going to be talking about that more. The parent ideas will build structure and unity around content and time. Did anybody attend last time the breakout where we did the hierarchy with the cards? So what I realized is once we're talking about all of these buckets, nobody knew the framework in which those buckets should be placed, right? So what if you've worked, 50 different jobs at the same institution? Well, I need help with that. And then I also need help isolating what's going to be the story that I tell, because that's a lot of work. So this is the effort to make that happen. If these ideas, going back to the parent ideas, if these ideas weren't used, the resume owner might be regarded as what we would call a job hopper. An important piece of copy at the end of many of these resumes is the subtle language that says, engagements and positions include. And we're going to see that a couple of times, actually every single time in our examples. This allows, and this is important, engagements and positions includes allows what? Allows some stints or gigs to be either blended or excluded. Because remember, at this point, it's an advertisement. It's not a documentary. In yellow, the child concepts are the next level in hierarchy, and we're going to see how that will work. The light blue here is buckets, or what I call JDA-shaped themes. The buckets are really, really what we're thinking of. These will help you to present to your readers at a glance the skills you bring to the table that will matter most. The JDA helps identify the skills, and we'll be doing a lot of that today. The pink is dates, and then, of course, the teal is when you hold multiple roles within the same organization. Okay, so while it's seemingly straightforward, the chronological presentation of your career can quickly devolve into what? A great deal of stress and anxiety. I have seen it. So the question is, you might ask, what if I've taught only spring semesters for 4 semesters? Or what if I held multiple or simultaneous roles in the same department? How do we handle that? These case studies will let us begin to unravel and put back together those ideas. They will build on themselves. So we're going to start with number 1 in a moment, and we're going to go through 5B. And you'll see how these ideas begin to repeat themselves. And you're like, oh, I get it. Or, oh, I can use that. And as you go through, think, I might want to come back to this because this handles this conundrum I've been dealing with. Of course, you'll have it at home, but I think now is a good time to even begin asking those questions. They're also, by the way, presented with permission of the original owners. I've fictionalized some, and some of the folks have said, say my name. Okay, because I'm loud and proud, Okay, what I'd like to do now is I'd like on your screen for you to have these. On the left, you're going to have case studies and exhibit number 1, Jane Smith. On the right, you're going to have Jane Smith, MBA. Okay. So I'll wait a moment while you perhaps get that in front of you. Okay. I'm going to kind of blaze through this because this is really framing, but what we're going to be hopefully spending most of our table work time on is those buckets that I keep talking about, or those branded bullet points. So here I go. Jane was fairly singularly minded. Jane had stayed in the same place or space and intended to stay in the same industry. The parent idea was therefore, what? Fairly easy to define, with music production. And if you look to the right, right down here in green, you'll see music production, right? So music production and, where is it? And administration was probably going along with her into her new career. We also used training to help unify everything within the 2009 to present timeframe, right? Because music and production was where she wanted to focus, but she, in her studies, had been teaching a fair bit of that time. She used the JDA to focus on the content she wanted to write about, but because the connection between what she's done and where she wants to go was already a close fit, there was no need to develop buckets to translate her story. In fact, Jane used a table in the executive summary to call out those core themes as defined by the JDA. Those that were defined by the JDA straddled her experience and also the connection, or rather, direction that she wanted to go. This table started gaining popularity in about 2000. Note, by the way, that Jane worked for different institutions, right? If you have that up there, you'll see that she worked for UC Davis, she worked for Catch the Music, University of California, Santa Cruz. Those institutions were what? Under the same parent idea. But she had held multiple roles with the same institutions. So in a traditional CV, this would be potentially a very, very long list of company names, right? Job titles and dates. In a resume, this long list of company names and jobs might go back to what we were talking about a moment ago, and she might be wrongly regarded as what? A job hopper. So the concept helps to unify this concept in that sort of teal color, helps to unify those many job titles and present the truth that she was, in fact, not what we would traditionally call a job hopper. Anyone paying attention to her original CV would realize that she had not been a job hopper, but that assumes that the reader on the end of the experience is going to stop, read, and digest the document spelling out all of those roles, right? That's the rub, because readers, resume readers, are coming to a snap judgment by glancing at the document for what, 10 seconds maybe, or less, before moving to the next resume, and there may be a pile of hundreds, if not thousands, of resumes that they're looking through. So the overarching 2006 to present dates represent a device to help unify Jane's supposed job hopping. Traditional job movement or hopping, or multiple jobs, often suggest a lack of stability on the part of the resume owner. And a lot of times people don't really realize that until they're sort of way down that rabbit hole. That sort of idea of job hopping is really, 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 you're really held at bay if you have too many quick jobs in succession. Of course, for Jane, it couldn't be further from the truth. So we're going to use, she's using devices like this to unify that story for that resume skimmer. I'd like now to move to case study two. So scroll up, and on the left, you're going to see case study number two, Corinne Smith. On the right, you'll see her resume. This is much, much quicker, right? Note the use of positions include. See right here, the second pink one down where it says positions include, that's what we were talking about a moment ago. This allows us again to do what? To blend or include or exclude certain positions that might not be relevant. So going back to the case study, she uses it where we don't have to list every last job title. It also allows her to omit or to truncate job titles into a single line. And so in teal on the example, you'll see that she truncated several of those jobs. And then she's going to write unifying content, scope of work, that sort of thing. Was she implied full-time or employed full-time? No, maybe, but probably not. Was she called on to do ad hoc work? Very likely. The truncating concept allows, again, to unify that episodic work. And then note that Corinne didn't create buckets, but she used the JDA, the job description analysis, to gather source material, decided to list those in big themes at the top of that example. Let's move on to case number 3. All right, Nicole Robinson. So like Exhibit 3, like Exhibit 2, actually, Nicole held multiple roles within the same organization. So if we look over here on the right, you can see that's the case. She wanted to keep two of those roles broken out because they carried significance for her intended audience or her purpose. And she had enough content for each of the two roles to make them a centerpiece in the document. Note that other roles are downplayed, even though, by the way, they may have occupied more of her time. Again, it's an advertisement, right? Not a documentary, a resume. The parent concept was not used as a skill unifier. We used University of California as that overarching concept. The decision, by the way, emerged after a lot of consideration about what to do with the UC adjacent work experience, which eventually became an additional activities unifier for any, and that's that second green on the example, right? It became a second place that she didn't want to lose. It fell outside of UC itself, but she didn't want, which again, with UC, she wanted to list that as center stage. The choice breaks the date convention a little bit because both of those dates end with to present, right? That's okay, as long as the content is clear to the reader. It's not necessarily preferable, but it's okay in this instance. By the way, we talked yesterday and there was some sort of lack of favor about using additional activities, and I remembered working with Nicole and I sort of pushed her on that. I was like, yeah, but you know, really we want to unify it under some sort of unifying skills, and she was like, ah, I don't have time for it, can't be bothered. Oh, okay, humanities administration would have worked. Yeah, you're right, absolutely. As I recall, we had 30 minutes, Nicole had lots of opinions, and so that's what we came to. Where was I? So, thank you for that, by the way. You want the document to be clear. So the additional activities was a laundry list, like a traditional CV previously, and then all of this was a laundry list, and then we bucketed it. So the additional activities were important, but kind of pulled focus from her center stage work. Nicole, again, did not use the JDA findings to create buckets, which remember, that's what we're going to be doing in a minute after I get done reading. However, the JDA findings informed her content that ultimately went into the document. Let's go now to Exhibit 4, Annabelle Merriweather, a fake name if I ever heard it. Annabelle Merriweather. This two-page exhibit, and this is interesting, feel free to scroll back and forth on the right, because it's a two-pager. So she uses all of the unifying ideas, right? Parent themes, child structure for institutions, and in some cases, multiple departments, and those dates. But for the first time, we also see the use of buckets to call attention to specific transferable skills. You can see those buckets appearing on page 1, right? So Annabelle may or may not have previously called out those transferable skills, not even known what to call them. So you'll see there program evaluation, development, administration, publicity and event planning, program outreach and management. But she used that language as a bridge to align the required skills and experience she identified in her JDA results, AKA the needs of the job market that aligned with her interests, with past work and experience that she could reasonably speak to, highlight, and defend in the interview process. This means that she, and I may go running off in the distance, but she shunned mentioning all other or irrelevant experience in favor of focusing tightly on those core areas. She focused her story on the intersection between what she has done and where she wants to go. This doesn't take away from the value of unmentioned work, right? This doesn't take away from the value of unmentioned work. I'll say it again. No. It simply filters her story for the audience in question, Remember that the JDA allowed her to figure out what her intended audience was calling the work she'd done? And again, language that she may or may not have otherwise used, or even known to use. Has she ever taught in a classroom? No doubt. Did she call out that skill set? Only in the lightest way, and mostly to give a nod to a pretty big part of her background, but she didn't set it center stage. So what I think is interesting about the second, that two-pager that you have in front of you, is those thematic unifiers, those sort of parent unifiers in green. You'll see on page one, I think it's program administration and publicity. And then page two, the top of page two, is a continuation of that same sort of organizer. But then at the bottom of page two, I think it's community involvement or activities or, yeah. So it allowed the reader at a glance to be able to see, hey, this is sort of where she's focused her time. Now she could, by the way, change that and say, okay, where is it I want to go? Can I slant it one direction or the other? And just by tuning that top level green sort of unifier, suddenly she's changed the lens for the reader who's reading it for the first time. All right, let's go to five. Case study five, scroll up. Cassia Roth. Now, building on what we've learned so far, this subject, Cassia, takes the buckets to a whole new level. And by the way, on your screen, you're going to see the first version of Cassia's, and if you scroll up one page, the right side, you'll see her second version. And this is where I had like a mind-blowing moment, even though right now is not very mind-blowing, but when I was trying to figure out how can I make this easy and how can I make it something that you can take away, I was like, okay, she did the work for me, right? So she takes the buckets to a whole new level. But first, let's go back and examine what we know and recognize at this point in terms of the hierarchy. Cassia spent all of her time in an academic environment and mostly within, what, the same department. It was easy then to define her parent topics, academic study, administration, and teaching, and then set those multiple roles with the same institution, UCLA Department of History, in the same child hierarchy. Note that because she'd only been at one institution, she didn't need to tinker with her dates. And in fact, the parent concept simply served to unify her multiple roles and functional categories of work. It also allowed her to call out areas where she wanted to focus, and it hedged against the at-a-glance appearance of the dreaded job hopping. Less likely, but possible, depending on how many roles she held between 09 and today in terms of job hopping. But this let her clearly present functional transferable content, which reflects ideas she gathered using the JDA. Note that Cassia put the buckets to remarkably good use. Examine that she not only tuned the parent idea. By the way, do you see moments where I'm like, because the green is super dark, I'm like, woo! She also tuned the buckets and the preceding paragraphs once she realized how the buckets could help her refine and present her story to a specific audience. Why? Because one audience might want to see the Exhibit 5A story, while another audience might want to see the Exhibit 5B story. At this point in her career, she can go actually several different directions. Kind of the sky is the limit. She just didn't necessarily know it. Cassia didn't make either audience slog through irrelevant content. Instead, she focused on what will matter to that audience. Does it take work? Yes, unfortunately it does. But this is part of the world we live in now for a lot of reasons. And it supports that old saw that you only get one time to make a first impression. In this case, you only get 10 seconds to make that first impression. All right, we're going to move now into the job description analysis. And it was this group of people, and I can finally get away from my reading here. It was this group of people who actually first coined it a JDA. Now my clients call it a JDA. So the job description analysis is this. It allows you to sort of gather job descriptions that might be interesting to you and try to figure out what skills or ideas are sought in that job description. So you can reverse engineer sort of what your intended audience will want, find the intersection between who you are, where you want to go, And then maybe identify some other factors, like are there maybe technical gaps in your experience that you might want to figure out? I have some clients who come along, they're like, you know, in 5 years, I want to be doing X. And I say, great, let's find out what that job looks like 5 years from now, and let's work backwards. What are buckets? Very simply, they are branded bullet points, and you've already seen the idea of branded bullet points makes sense now that you've seen it on that page, right? So behind the scenes, they're core skills or themes that are sought by potential employers. They are presented as core story themes, and they're visually bundled for various reasons. So if you saw Cassia's resume, right, let's go to her resume again, just in your mind or looking at it. On the one, you can see that she has, I think, program management at one point. There were some other things. It was a little sort of broader, softer. It was her first attempt at this. And when she sent me back the second one, it was like, oh, so she has now made it clear to me that she has that skill set. Because when I glance at that, I know exactly what it is. Do I read everything that came after? Maybe. Maybe not. Do I, as the first person in the sort of first line of defense, read the whole thing? Probably not, right? If I'm someone who's sort of on the front lines deciding whether she's going to get an interview, I'm probably not going to read the whole thing. When it comes to me as the recruiter maybe having to sort of present her as a candidate to my client or as a candidate internally and say, you know what, this person looks really good and I've met her and we should talk to her, I might actually then go into the resume and read the whole thing and sort of borrow stuff that she's written and put it into my own dossiers that I'm going to be presenting to the next step. So that's what buckets are. Another nice thing about buckets, not only can you mix and match them like Cassia did, and you should, but you can go in and tune each of those buckets relatively easily. So let's say you had budget management as one of your buckets. Because by the way, budget management is really important, and you should acknowledge it now, because it's budget management and team management are the things that distinguish you from continuing on as an individual contributor or as an IC, or moving into a management position and going up. And so it's nice to know that. Do I want to stay as an individual contributor? Don't manage a budget. If you're looking to move up, in terms of hierarchy, I'm an individual contributor, by the way, because I hate managing people. I have, and I really didn't enjoy it. So I'm happy with that. I probably wouldn't put that kind of experience on my own resume, right? So it's good to know. Back to my original point, though, the budget management, let's say that she's written this beautiful resume, and that's one of her buckets, and then she realizes in this one job description that they're calling it expense management. She doesn't have to write a whole new bucket. She can just change the keyword, right? Just change the branded part of the bullet. Super easy. The human reader gets to see, oh yeah, totally, because they're seeing their own stuff come back at them and they're not having to take the time to filter. But also there's this thing I've talked about and you probably know about, this horrid thing called the applicant tracking system, where your resume probably is going to have to go and be read. The keywords that it searches for are in the job description, most generally, right? Because let's say I write a job description, I go down the hall to the keyword coder and I say, would you put this in the computer? And you say, yep, expense management, dot, 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 right? So then along comes the resume that says budget management. Does it get picked up? Maybe, maybe not. So I realize I'm sort of harping on that, but it's such a clever way to just sort of tweak it so it hits all of those audiences. Now buckets, why buckets? Again, some audiences are going to want to see, audiences are going to want to see some skills, and others are going to want to see other skills. It's up to us, again, to filter who sees what, and because 30 versions of a resume is painful. Who has at least 10 versions of a resume? Oh, you are. I don't think everybody's raising their hand. Okay. You're better than I. You may have, at some point, 30 versions of a resume. Okay. So from crazy town to organized. All right. Did the JDAs feel a little like, this is sort of helpful, but I don't entirely know what to do? Right? You're like, well, I only know this because others who are now drinking the Kool-Aid had that experience the first time themselves. So I thought what I might do is take an example of someone who's outside of the humanities right outside of what we would expect, just because I think it's nice to see another perspective. We will soon see plenty of humanities stuff. So today is really about sort of taking your JDA, making it feel less crazy, and making it useful, and that's where we're going to do our table work. So this is an example of a JDA that comes to me when a client is done. One of their assignments, do the JDA, let's come together and have a strategy meeting. So line number four, or row four, is product development, right? That's pretty clear. It's going to be all based around product. I'm probably not going to talk about, well, product is pretty comprehensive. I'm probably not going to talk about teaching children. Okay, there we go. Something very different. Under that is quality and reliability. That focuses down into the product and how that product is developed and then launched. Technology development, that's kind of synonymous with product, or can be, right? Technology transfer is a certain way of manufacturing. We move on down, and this is pretty clear, but for this person, see those nicely, those are buckets. The green, the blue, the purple. What we did is, in that row on the left, is we tried to isolate 1 to 3 word ideas. And then, once that was all done, it looked like a rainbow. And I said, okay, hang up, I'm gonna now go in and organize it, and I reordered all the rows. So we have, you know, when they get it, they're like, ah, yay. And then what happens for me is when I'm working with them, I say, you know, we're always going to go back and cross-reference this. There are times when I'm sitting there, I'm like, I don't know the answer exactly. And the client is like, yeah, I don't know either. I'm like, I wonder what the JDA tells us. And then we go back. So notice, of course, that we're keeping all those descriptions on the right, but we have isolated them. Also, another thing that I will do is, as I'm writing, I'm going to bucket these ideas on the left, but I'm also going to use the stuff on the right as fodder for the content that I write inside those buckets, which is super helpful. Do you want to necessarily copy it verbatim? Probably not, right? So what you've done so far, this is step one in the JDA, and congratulations. You have researched and pulled down some interesting job descriptions. Annie, very sort of helpfully, said about a week ago, she's like, you know, one of the problems was, oh, sorry. One of the problems, the other voice in my head. One of the problems is that we don't know what to enter into Indeed or into LinkedIn or to Google, right? And so I was really grateful when she said, I'm gonna send out this little note to help people do the JDA, because that maybe that's why we were having this sort of brrrr happen on the last day. So thank you to Annie for that. So we're going to group like job titles and positions. You've already done that. Now, I suspect you probably only did one. JDA, did anybody get really ambitious and do two? Ah, oh my God, did anybody do three? Take a bow. Okay, that's exciting. That's very exciting, because when I talk to people, I say, okay, let's consider door one, door two, door three. JDA 1, JDA 2, JDA 3. This is really, really helpful, because a lot of times door 1 is the safe door. Yeah, definitely I'm a shoo-in, and the JDA is going to help me to write the content. Door 2 is like, I want to expand a little bit. I might want to enhance. I want to move up. So JDA 2 is all about that, door 2. And JDA 3 is fantasy or stretch. Now, it doesn't have to be. I'm using this by way of example, right? I can enter in door one proudly. Everything is going well. Door two, I can make some plans and try to figure out. But, you know, yeah, that's all good. Door three, I look in and I'm like, no, I do not want to go that direction. Thank you very much. I just saved a whole lot of grief, time with the, you know, therapist or whatever it might be. Because door three, I was really out of my mind. So I do have people actually come into my office. And I had a CFO recently do that very thing. She came in and said, well, that was interesting. And she threw down the papers on the desk and said, I was insane. I do not want to do number three. And so I call that a fantasy killer. So it's actually super helpful, because there's nothing wrong with exploring that, is there? Right? There's nothing wrong with exploring it. And I will also say that people come back and say, so I've been doing the JDA, and they find themselves doing it again and again. And I know some of you in the room have also already done that. So what we're looking to do is, again, unearth and identify and present the intersection between your skills, what's sought by an employer. There may be multiple intersections. Some employers are going to want some, and some of them are going to want others. What if Cassia, remember she had a set of buckets over here. How am I on time? Do we know? What time is it? It's 2:50. I had better blaze. Okay. I'd like to move right along. So JDA 1 had 37, JDA 2 had 52 rows, and JDA 3 had 26. We're going to do some table work, and I think I'm going to have to clip this to 10 minutes. Table captains, again, raise your hands so the folks at your table know who you are. What we're going to do in this next 10 minutes is analyze your findings, and we're going to bucket them into like ideas, just like I did a little bit earlier. So again, you can think of it as overlap so that you can start creating some themes. I went ahead and threw this into the presentation from yesterday to remind the career counselors what this was all about. And Annie said, let's keep that yes and no right there. So starting now, let's do 10 minutes, get out your JDAs, and let's start figuring out what those core themes are. All right, everybody, I have to cut this party short. I gave us an extra 3 minutes, so we had a total of 13 minutes. I'm going to go 10 minutes over because we started 10 minutes late, and this is too important, so I'm going to do it. Something I had a couple of questions when I was talking to folks was, one was study abroad, and what was it? Study abroad programming. And the question was, well, what do I do with that? Because, you know, how do I organize that bucket? Well, what you want to do is you want to say, okay, the programming part of that is probably the important piece. Program development, management, whatever it might be. And I would imagine there are other program development and management things you've done elsewhere. So that gives a clue. The study abroad piece, yeah, that's what was being sought in that particular job description. But cut that out and maybe add that as part of the narrative. So the brand is program development. This happened yesterday when we were looking at, where was it? Oh, policy. Like there was policy, and then there was a point at which it was like, oh yeah, oh, I remember what it was. Program oversight, sorry, in column C. So program oversight, that person in D, by the way, see on columns D and E, I use red, yellow, green light. Red means when you say no, you don't have the experience, but green means yes, I do have that experience. Yellow means maybe or ish. So, but what I realized is, and the person who owns this JDA, this is one of her first ones, she's like, I cannot believe I said no. Because what was I thinking? I was like crazy. She's like, around organizing seminars and developing programs, something. She was like, I can't believe it. But my point is, for her at that time, she felt like she had not done program oversight. However, she's been involved in program, right? Did she contribute to program development? Did she contribute to execution of programs? Was she part of a 6-member team that oversaw programs, right? She's like, oh. So that's another thing, is one of the prompts I have up there, but I blazed on by because I'm running a little behind, was that it may be asking for something, but this is just the purpose of research and shaking a tree and trying to figure out, what can I, wire my story around, right? So that get over the oversight, don't worry about the verb, and just do the thing. Okay, so the next up is going to be a quick little assignment. You've got 4 minutes. I want you to pull out or isolate or choose 4 buckets that you identified, right? Some examples here, program development administration, publishing, outreach, graphic design. 4 minutes to pick the 4 that you think you'd like to do something with. Go.
Hi, everybody.
We have another, I'm sure you've identified at least 2, maybe 3. Now what I'd like you to do is take the next 4 minutes to choose the single, oops, nope. Take the next 4 minutes to choose the single most comfortable bucket or theme from those 4, right? So you've isolated 4. Now I want you to, I'm going to start the timer now. I want you to figure out a single theme. Now, obviously, you're going to have more themes eventually, but we want to have the experience here so you can replicate it later. Go. Oh, wait, sorry. Then you're going to choose the time frame that your bucket will cover. So the examples here are program development and administration when I was a graduate fellow at XYZ research program, or writing and publishing over the course of my entire PhD program. All right, now go. We're just doing one. Yes. Yeah. It's not an actual thing. Yeah. It would just be part of your narrative. It would just be, it would not be a bucket it would flow into. In fact, I'm going to mention that. So I just had a question that I think resonates with everybody, because not all of the content on your JDA is going to be a bucket, right? So what if it asks for leadership? Well, it would be a little weird to put leadership as like your sort of branded part of your bullet. The leadership is it's either A, what you did, so you're demonstrating the leadership, or the word leadership can go somewhere into the narrative, right? Collaboration is another example of that. Collaborative could become a descriptor, but it's not necessarily going to be the branded part of the bucket. Sorry to bring it down, but carry on. All right, our next exercise is to, the reason we wanted to isolate it to a single bucket that you feel comfortable with is we're now going to quantify your accomplishments and your scope of work within the lens or the framework of that bucket. What I don't necessarily want, unless you process this way, is to necessarily write, right? We don't want to write the narrative yet. I just want you to throw stuff in the bucket, and the quantifying is actually somewhat difficult to do, so we have, if you go to the, remember the one that had the, where was it? The case studies? So in the back of the case studies, there are three pages. It starts with teaching bucket, and then under that are some bullet points that give the questions that were asked in order to arrive at some of that content. So there are three. There's teaching bucket, there's program development and management, there is an expense and budget management bucket as well. So let's go ahead and we're gonna take 10 minutes to do this quantifying work. Quantifying is, let me think about, so it can be the team you worked on, what size the team was. It could be the, you know, a lot of times in traditional resumes will be like, how much money did I save? How much money did I bring in? How much time was saved? Where did I sort of make a big change? But here, there are not a lot of those metrics. So you want to talk about how many continents did I do research on? How many months did it take? Did I have some research money that was funneled into that work? And can I aggregate that? So there may have been, four or six or 10 or 500 grants that sort of funneled into that, aggregate that total. So time and space and things can be quantified, and hopefully this is where the career counselors can continue to help how to quantify. You can go ahead and take down my mic. All right, so we had some really interesting things, and it was fun to see eyeballs and, sort of lighting up as we found quantitative ideas, like, how do I quantify a committee? Well, how many people are on the committee? Well, how many committees, first of all, right? Five committees, ranging in size from 4 to 20 people. and then, you know, who worked on programs that were, you know, 2 months to 5 years long. Another was contracts. You know, what are those, what was one contract? Really probably don't want to say one contract, but I was like, okay, so how many people were on the, you know, the group that negotiated the contract, and did it, was it, you know, was that contract won or finally signed? And so there was a number of those, and then how many constituents, and in this case it was collective bargaining, I believe, it was a union contract, how many people did that impact? 13,000? Like, sort of just got goosebumps, because like suddenly you're quantifying and telling this really amazing story, and then it was like, oh, but there was this other that sort of went into it, and it was like, you know, some other tens of thousands of people, and suddenly that story is becoming really rich. So I want to go ahead and just read this, because, you know, I haven't done enough reading. This someone sent in a couple times ago this note at the bottom. It says, on another note, I wanted to mention that one of the most difficult aspects of creating this document, aside from establishing a chronology, was figuring out how to quantify entries. I understand why this is so important, but most of the work that a humanities graduate student performs isn't easily quantifiable, or more correctly, isn't thought of as such, right? That being said, the example resume on the Humanists at Work website helped me think about how I might find more humanistic ways of quantifying, such as listing the different groups, departments, and publics that I worked with. I don't know if other graduate students you have worked with have mentioned this, all of them, but one of the biggest takeaways from working with you was finding a humanistic way of quantifying my work. And that was an email, and I just copied and pasted it. So the next thing we're going to do, let me get my clicker, is we're going to spend 10 minutes drafting a narrative for the bucket that you've chosen, that you've quantified. You're going to start it with a verb. And remember, if you want to see some examples, it's in the last three pages of the case studies. So there are those three example buckets. You may have not chosen the teaching bucket. You may have not chosen the program administration bucket. But you can still look at the pattern and follow the pattern. When you're finished, what we'd like to do is each of you, each table has one of these big stickies. And we want the bucket to be, remember, these buckets are actually branded bullet points, right? They're eventually going to go on the resume. But if you don't mind, and if you feel comfortable, write your narrative. You know, good, bad, or ugly, this is just an attempt. And then put them on the wall. Which wall? Oh, they're going to go on the easels, I see, throughout the place. Okay. So, and I think it'd be interesting if we have time, and we may not, to have somebody read them aloud, because I've had a couple of goosebump moments, and I'd love to hear sort of what comes of it. But I also think it'd be interesting throughout the rest of the day for folks to be able to look at what other people have done and get inspiration beyond just these few that we have. So go, 10 minutes. All right, as you're finishing up and we're putting the things on the wall, there are two other things that I wanted to share. One person said, I have many projects, right, that are related to this same bucket. I feel like it's getting kind of long. And I said, could you potentially aggregate those into a single statement? So, you know, oversaw or participated on 5 projects, and then just take all those quantitative details and whoop, level them up into some sort of an aggregate statement. And the other one that I know we all have a hard time with, I certainly still do, is when to stop writing, right? So my rule of thumb for a bucket is 3 and potentially 4 lines. 4 lines gets a little long for me. 3 lines, which is not typical, I would say, in all resumes, right? Specifically, like maybe a salesperson, they might have 1 line, 1 line, 1 line, 1 line. Well, that's sales. What we do requires context, right? But in the telling of the context, sometimes we can just go on and on and on. So I would write it out. Go ahead and write it out in the aggregate, and then challenge yourself to edit. And an editing device for me is, okay, what is important to get the call, and then what can be preserved and held back as talking points. We don't have time for Q&A. I don't know what is next, but I know that my time is up. So thank you very much, everybody.
I was supposed to-
up there if you don't want to say something.
I thought she was going to say, let's take a vote. I don't want to see the no votes. Who wants to do a Q&A? Nobody. Okay, are there any questions? Dana, do you want to be the microphone, Oprah?
Questions?
Okay.
So I'm curious, so I have a few JDA, a few different positions now that I'm looking at. And so then those lists got really long of all the skills or qualifications they were calling for in the job call. And so then going back and forth between the resume and the JDA and wanting to be sensitive to the electronic word search things, where is the balance between making sure you get hit all the key words, but condensing and summarizing into buckets?
Right. It's a very, very hard and good question because some job descriptions are entirely long, right? So there are times when you might be able to combine two similar ideas in the same bucket. And of course, at the moment, I'm going entirely blank. Let's say program development and outreach. Those two things could have been separate, but you could also probably bundle them. And I know I'm saying program development a lot, but it's a good example. That's a world that I wrestle with myself still. And you have to say, okay, where can I aggregate? Where can I combine? What can I drop off of this one? And sometimes with a client, I will actually have like 10 different branded bullet points in a separate document. And then I'll say, these are what you're going to use to mix and match depending on who your audience is. That's how I approach it. But it's part of the agony, I have to say.
Hi.
Hi.
I don't even know how to ask this question.
You said so, a lot for comparative literature at UCLA.
Okay.
I've been involved in developing diversity or inclusive pedagogies as well as service learning pedagogies. And I actually developed a pilot program for our department in Comp Lit. But then within that, so I developed a course. And so within that, I did a bunch of little things that kind of all contributed to that one thing. Could I call that a program? Or could I call it, like, what would be, like, a good kind of catch-all term to use in these kinds of situations?
Is it a curriculum?
It's curriculum, but... Yeah, there were like different events that contributed, because I don't know if I could call it it's a very specific question. Maybe I could just ask you myself.
Sure.
So that's one question.
I think it's actually probably good, and there are people who are like, yes, tell.
So basically, I developed a course, and then I taught that course without any guidance, mind
you.
And then there were all of these little things that I had to do towards developing that course.
Right.
And so I don't know if I can just call it a course or if I should call it a program, because a program sounds more impressive.
Well, if it was outside of the academy, you could call it a program.
Okay.
Right? Program design
and
delivery. Program design and implementation.
Okay.
It's a little different from a program you might develop in a nonprofit setting or a government setting, but you could write it so that it mirrored it, right? So the person reading it, you're sort of giving them that bridge, and then they're taking it and they're continuing the translation of it.
Okay.
And then another thing that you just reminded me of is, let's say that you've had, you've done that 5 times, and you could say, developed 5 multidisciplinary programs impacting, you know, a total of 52,000 people, comma, including example A, example B, and example C.
Okay.
So, and really where that becomes important, for instance, is if you have something that there's a lot of, let me think of an example. So let's say you're a marketer and you've led 60 campaigns. Well, a lot of people will just focus on one, right? 2 or 3. Well, what if, because they're the most impressive, what if you said, you know, directed the design, blah, and launch of 60 marketing campaigns, including, ultimately brought in X revenue. And I'm sorry I'm going corporate for a second, but it's easier for me. Including, the LifeScan medical device, the this medical device, and the that medical device. So you're giving the three most interesting examples. And I think you can do that in the same way here. If you look at the body of work, if it's teaching, right, you may have had over the course of your time, I'm not going to give a number. If you didn't know, my first presentation, I made an absolute fool of myself by saying, a 50-page dissertation.
Well, you can't teach more than like 12 classes at UCLA.
Okay, so 12 courses, right? Thank you, because I didn't know if it was 500 or 12. Including, and then you choose some relevant subset of that. I don't know if that entirely answers. Okay. Any other questions?
In some ways, Lisa, can I steal your example and keep talking? Because I think the other thing that her example made me think of was how part of what I noticed in these resumes is that they're more, the buckets are more skill-oriented or like capacities, capabilities that you have, rather than necessarily being chronological by the job title that you had or the place where you worked, which then means you might, in an instance like that, also have like event planning and something in one bucket, but curriculum stuff in another bucket. So you might end up talking about the same position in multiple buckets, which it sounds like is okay as long as you're not sort of filling them in with like falsely, as long as you're like, does that sort of
That's exactly right. Like, because you can aggregate or you can deconstruct those as much as you want. And the teal color that allows you to sort of put multiple job titles on the same line, then you can really either wrap it up or you can spread it out. Yeah, thank you for that. That's excellent.
Okay.
It's perfect, in fact. Yeah. Are you looking for a job?
All right, well, let's thank Jared one more time.
Thank you. Namaste.